G'day, welcome to another class on the marketing function. So if you've been following this video, you would have been able to complete the product policy, the price policy, as we've been following the marketing functions, which includes the four policies, the four P's of marketing, which is price, product, place, which is what we're going to be focusing on today, which is distribution, and then we'll be doing promotions in the following video, which is your promotional marketing. Okay, so let's delve in. So again, we start with our four main brands, their distribution, and if I have to look in particular at the top two, Coke and Nike, their distribution policies are one of the best, and it's also which made them the top companies that they are, not just their exquisite products or excellent quality products, not just their pricing, but also the way how they get their products from the manufacturing site all the way to the customer home. So I said we'll be focusing on the distribution policy. What you should be able to know or be able to explain is the meaning of distribution, the channels of distribution, the differences between direct and indirect, what's the meaning of intermediary, what's the types of intermediaries, what's the role of the intermediaries. You have to be able to draw a channel of distribution and explain the reasons why manufacturers would prefer to either make use of direct or indirect distribution methods. That's the pros, cons, so they can ask you critically, evaluate, give reasons for or answers against. Then with this draw the channel of distribution, they might give you a case study to say, okay, in this scenario, which distribution channel would you recommend? Then you have to draw your own based on the information given in the case study. So just the third P, place, I said. So let's start. Distribution. What is distribution? Distribution is a policy that the business knows how and when to distribute and where to distribute the product to. So you need to understand, if you have a product that you manufacture in China and you want to sell it in South Africa, you need to know how you're gonna get it from China to South Africa, and where you're gonna sell it in South Africa. Okay, it doesn't matter if you can get it in South Africa, but you don't know the specifics of where. So this is a very crucial part. So it's not just the launching into space and hoping that you'll fall at the right place. You need to understand exactly. Okay, so it's about how the business gets the product to its customers. So once you have your product and you need to have your price, you need to make sure that the consumers get it in order to buy it. And you need to have that at the right place at the right time. But I've also added numerous times in previous videos, it's not just the right place and time. It's the right quantity. It's the right quality. We can add more rights to this than this whole list. So I want you to make a few notes of what you think is also important to understand with regards to distribution. So products need to be distributed from the place where they're manufactured to the marketplace. Now there you can see some stickers that's normally on a case. So it says this side up or fragile or do not get wet. And the right hand side looks like please don't kick it. It's just a joke. So, as we said, it's about from the place of manufacture, where it's loaded onto a truck, it's transported via whichever way, not a taxi or a helicopter though, and then it will all end up to the consumer, to where they are happy, where they're able to buy it. Okay, so that's the introduction. What's a distribution? So what's a channel? So this is the path which the product is moved from the customer to the from producer to the customer. Okay, and you need to be able to plan carefully the route. You don't want to travel with your product excessively, because that adds to the cost and time, And also, it can add up to the risk. The longer you have the product, the more the risk is in your court, which means the longer you have to pay insurance and carry that risk should something happen. It's important that the channel is the most efficient, effective and cost efficient, as I explained now. So make sure that when you have your channel, it's as lean as possible. Lean means the minimum that is required to do it effectively. Okay, so it doesn't mean anything else than what the word says. It's just it's simple. You have to keep it simple, keep it to the bare necessities. So let's say I've got a warehouse in Johannesburg and I need to get it in Cape Town. Then from my warehouse, I'll load it onto a truck. I'll transport it to Cape Town to the warehouse there, and from there I'll have a smaller warehouse where I'll be distributing with smaller trucks. Okay, so it's a simple way. It's not if I, let's say for example, I keep one truck and I do all my deliveries with the Superlink. Do you think that will be effective? Chances are no, because you don't want your Superlink to do small hauls or go into residential areas, because that's time consuming and you want your product moved as fast as possible. Okay. Distribution channel is made up of this many businesses that will help to move the product. It starts with the producer and it ends with the final consumer. And as we said earlier, it must make sure that the right product is available at the right time. So there's three kinds of participants in this distribution channel. It's a service provider, it's an intermediary, and it's a customer. Now I want you to also look at your textbooks, grade 11, page 96. As you'll see, more of a detailed explanation. Okay, so let's get into the meaning of intermediaries. What is an intermediary? An intermediary can be defined as it's all the people that fall in the distribution process between the producer and the consumer. So that's everyone. Okay, if you have a link between the producer and the consumer, then you're an intermediary with different names. Now, ideally, if I produce a product, I want to be able to sell it directly to the consumer. That means more profit to me and they pay a lower price quicker. But I can't reach all of South Africa from my small house in Jeffreys Bay. I need to be able to have a larger network, and that's where intermediaries come into the picture. The moment you want to expand, you need to have a team, you need to be able to handle the pressure, the networks. And this is why there's intermediaries. So, as you can see, they are the middlemen and they will act as negotiators and mediators between the producer and the consumers. Okay, so here you can see, so they form a link, they hold hands with the producer and with the consumer. And it's almost like, you know, that storytelling of that we played when you played as kids. When you hear a story and then you have to share the story with the person next to you, or the idea or the thought, and then you'd see what comes, what's the end result. So here it is exactly, but here you can't afford that the end result is not the same as the starting point. So this middleman needs to understand exactly what he's selling. Okay, so again, it comes back to knowing your product. So intermediaries can be wholesalers, can be retailers, agents or brokers. And there you can see that's another word for reseller or icon. That means for one person, that means I will distribute to three others. Okay, they are responsible for transportation, storage and delivery. Now, whenever you see that, you might think transportation and delivery. Why is it stored separate? Why do they state this separately? Transportation is normally from a manufacturing site to a warehouse. Storage is then at the warehouse where they receive it, store it, and then delivery means they will break it up into smaller packets. And it's still transport, but they will deliver it to the final destination, which is either retailers or consumers. Okay, the organizations involved are called intermediaries. So now you've got a better understanding of who is the intermediaries. Now let's look at the different types. So the first one is wholesalers will sell primarily their goods to retailers. They want to get their products quickly out of from their warehouse. So they've bought in bulk from one manufacturer or two. Now, as you can see in the picture, that purple image, the top left is the manufacturer. They manufacture and they sell in bulk to the wholesalers. Now they will want to sell in bigger quantities to retailers, because consumers will not necessarily buy pallets of food, but retailers will. So they'll have a network of retailers that will buy from them. So their primary goal is to sell to retailers. Retailers will then take that big pallet or the boxes of goods, break it up into smaller pieces, and that goes directly to the final consumer. Then you get agents, as in the bottom right. They sell products on behalf of manufacturers for a commission. So agents can be between manufacturers and wholesalers, between wholesalers and retailers, between retailers and consumers. So as long as there's someone that sells you a product, that can be an agent. Okay, so there's a good example is Avon. They use a direct method. You don't necessarily find them in shopping centers or in a shop, or for example, where they have a lot of overheads, but they've got trained agents nationwide, and they've got a massive manufacturing and distribution warehouse up in Johannesburg, and their network of people that sells their products are quite massive. So it's normally a person or a group a person that will represent, so sales rep. And other examples I'm going to think of is your Herbalife or other products that you will not necessarily, you can find it on the shelves, but not in every store. Brokers is a person who buys and sells goods for others. So that can just be someone, for example, I will buy and sell goods on behalf of a company or for someone. Okay, a role of intermediaries. So their first part is they need to find and locate buyers. Okay, it's like Finding Nemo. You need to understand where you're looking, where the customers are hiding, and you need to be able to find the right people, the right target market. Remember, you can find people, but it doesn't mean they're the target market. You can find people, but they won't necessarily buy because they're not interested. They don't have the problem. If you don't have the problem, you won't buy. You need to understand that you need to find people with the same problem. That's quite easy these days with technology, but it's still something you have to focus on. And they also help with promoting the product. Okay, it's about getting the word out there, word of mouth, getting people to write positive reviews, sharing information. Intermediaries are the specialists. So this is one thing that if you're a producer, you're not a specialist in this. So they're specialists in selling. Okay, so your target audience is much bigger than if you're just a producer trying to sell your product. So they've got massive amounts of people or audiences that follows them, and that means you'll be able to sell to more people, making a bigger profit. They can achieve greater sales. They produce a man of that expertise, but these people will. So think about, let's take a big company that sells sports shoes, for example. That's one of my favorite pastimes, is walking into a sports shop that sells shoes, and I would ask just a few basic questions of what shoes do you have for pronating or antinate or supernate, whatever. Or where is the neutral shoes? And the response is my first impression of the company. So let's say the sales rep on the floor says, you know, sir, sorry, we don't have that brand. Then immediately I say, thank you very much, you've been helpful, and I walk out. And I know that they will have no idea what type of shoe I need. They are not experts. And they are just there because they are trying to sell a product and not necessarily solve a problem. Because the moment you know your product, then you will be able to train others into knowing your product. And that means that when people ask you questions, you'll be able to answer it effectively, and that means there will be a bigger target market or actual service that you will provide. Okay, intermediaries may be able to provide more efficient distribution logistics. Okay, this is an important one. So let's say I am a producer and I want to get the products from one warehouse to another. So I will then have to go and rent trucks or buy trucks, but I'm not in transport, you know. Now there's a lot of cost involved in transport, getting a driver. Now you have to employ more people, and it's all additional cost, and you have to carry all of that, not just the part of when you use the truck. But when you outsource, when you get someone in, intermediary, that's a transport company, it's their job, they're excellent, they're specialists in that, they can give it to you at better rates than you give it to yourself. So you don't have to buy a truck, you get the transport, they cover the insurance of your products, and they ensure that it's delivered on time. If it's not, there's penalties involved. So excellent examples of these are your DHLs, your DSVs, RTT transport. Well, you know, there's quite a lot of transport companies out there, RM, hand-to-hand, but it all depends on what their focus is on. But I know DHL has got a massive fleet, and they serve primarily, well, they're in every industry. They're quite big, they're in the world. I think they're number one in the world currently, with DSV just behind them. Okay, overall distribution cost may be lower if you use an intermediary than if your business undertook the distribution itself. So that's why I said you don't need to buy a truck or buy a warehouse or buy this or buy racking or buy a system which you would need. But they would already have that, and you'll only pay for a portion of that, as they've got other customers as well. So it's a shared cost, basically. Okay, distribution channels. So we're going to look at the following channels. The first one is from a producer to an agent to a wholesaler, retailer, consumer. You can see every person got their link. They want their part of the cut, so they add. We call it, it's either a value-adding chain or it's a non-value-adding chain, but they're adding their profit to it. Then you get the shorter one from producer directly to the distributor, retailer, consumer. Now, what's the difference between a wholesaler and a distributor? A wholesaler is someone that will buy your products, okay? And then they will sell it directly. For example, this one, the producer, the wholesaler will buy it from the producer, they'll break it into smaller packs for retailers, they'll break it into smaller packs for consumers. Whereas the second one is the producer will just find someone, agent or another intermediary, will be a distributor for them. Okay, so they'll just send it to a warehouse where the packages will be broken up, but it's still not, it's still the items, or it still belongs to the producer. Okay, then you get the producer, and they will sell directly to the retailers. So there you can see it's a shorter chain, and then the quickest, the most efficient one, if you can do it, is direct from the producer to the consumer. Now, that's not always possible. There's somewhere is there is a hand involved in helping, but this is what you want. You want to get that chain as fast as possible. Okay. But if the moment you want to have a bigger reach, you need more people to assist you. So let's look. The first one is directly from the manufacturer producer to the consumer. So this is the shortest one, and it's normally found in your public sector. Then you get your manufacturer, the producer, to a retailer, to a consumer. Now, what's a retailer? A retailer is normally your shops that you as a consumer's got access to. So that will be your ShopRite Checkers, your Clicks, your Spar, your Pick and Pay, etc. Okay, so they sell goods to a consumer and by using a retailer. So they'll sell to the retailer in bigger quantities, will then be able to break it up for a consumer to buy in small quantities. It's also important, something a fact to remember is the if you that the producer, remember, they're producing in bulk. So when you want to sell something, you don't necessarily want to sell one to one to one to one or one on one products. You want to sell in bulk, and that's why you need wholesalers or retailers, because they will buy in bigger quantities. That means you can give them better prices, but if you have to sell one by one, it's going to take you a long time to sell to every person. That's why you want a central point for people to come together, for example at the retail shop, and there everyone can come and buy their stock, whatever they need, and that's from someone that bought in bulk, so that's much easier. Hope that makes sense. So from the retail to consumer, that's a single distribution channel. It's aimed to sell to large scale retailers. Next one is a manufacturer to a wholesaler to retail consumer. So this is your traditional method. So the you as a consumer will go buy from the shop, pick and pay, and they will buy from a wholesaler, which in turn gets stock from the manufacturer. But in this case, I just want to maybe let's highlight something else. A retailer, let's say the retailer here is the foreigner shop on the corner, the Greek shop or the Pakistani shop or the Chinese shop. They are the retailers. You're a consumer, they buy from a wholesaler either in South Africa or outside, or a spaza shop. They mostly buy from cash and carry or those trading shops on macro. So that's a good example. If you think of pick and pay, let's discuss pick and pay quickly. Where do you think they will fit in? Do they buy from a wholesaler? No, they want to cut out that part of a middleman. So pick and pay in this instance. Okay, so let's just focus or continue with this. It's a rural area, so this is more the spaza shops that I said. So this is, let's talk this one quickly. I'll get back to the pick and pay thought now. Manufacturer, wholesaler, retailer. So this is where the wholesaler buys from the producer and sells directly to the retailers. This is your cash and carry wholesalers that sells directly to retailers for consumption. Okay, manufacturer, producer, your agent, wholesaler, retailer, consumer. This is agents often connect the manufacturer to the wholesaler or retailer. And then the more intermediaries that are on distribution channel, the more consumers, etc. Now, let's quickly talk about pick and pay or checkers. If you think, are they the manufacturer of the products? No. They give us direct access. So they're the retailers, right? And they don't force us to buy in bulk. So they're not a wholesaler. Although they have a massive variety of items. But do they buy from a wholesaler? No, they've got their own storage facilities. So in this case, it will be a manufacturer, right, selling to pick and pay in bulk, and then they will be the retailer. So I believe, and pick and pay can then either have their own warehouse, or they can outsource it to another company, which will then be an agent. So then the outsource, the wholesaler will not be part of it. So I think, if we go back to the previous slide, pick and pay would actually fall into the manufacturer, retailer, consumer channel, with another few others in between, because they've got transporting from the producer to a warehouse to their different shops and then to the consumer. Okay, but can you see how it works? It's quite interesting when you understand that. Okay, what's the difference between direct and indirect channels? So direct channel, when you've got direct, you can carry all the risks. It involves the producer and the consumer. The wholesale and the retailers are cut from the process, so there's no middleman. Marketing is involved, there's no middleman, so you have to do your own marketing, your own selling. You have full control over the product in your marketing. There's better end user price, so there's no intermediary cost. There's immediate feedback that you can get. But there's a downfall, you need more specialized employees who are trained. This is like an example I gave you earlier of the sports shoes. If your people are not trained, then you will lose clients. There's better end user price, there's no intermediary cost, okay, that's a double. indirect channel of distribution, so the risks are shifted to intermediaries during the distribution. So here you don't have to pay insurance, for example, because it's covered. You are indemnified. There's no risk for you. There's a middleman between the producer and consumer. Wholesalers and retailers are negotiators between the producer and consumer. So if I buy from a producer, then I can negotiate better prices from him because I'm buying in bulk. The more you buy, the better the price. Even in a retail shop, for example, sometimes I can say buy two, get the third for three for free. That's a promotion strategy, but that's sometimes a strategy that the wholesalers follow as well in order to get better prices, so they can ask similar prices, so the consumer doesn't pay so much. Okay, specialized agents deal with customers. So you've got people that specifically trained in how to deal. They've got a lot of followers, or they know how to reach the target market. And there's little feedback from customers because there's such a wide variety of customers. The transportation and storage is taken care of. The manufacturers make use of middlemen, such as your wholesalers, agents, brokers, or retailers. And in this case, the manufacturer is not knowledgeable about the distribution of the product. They want to focus on their core business, and therefore they've not taken on this part. And the products may be expensive as the intermediary costs are added. Okay, now you have to be able to understand what's the difference between direct and indirect and explain it, so critically evaluate. So it's everything that we just said, but just with a focus on direct. So there's full control of the product and marketing in a direct distribution channel. It's cheaper, it's a better end user price. Okay, good term to know, an end user price or consumer price, because there's no intermediary cost. Business do not need to share its profit margin. Products can become very expensive once all the intermediaries have added their own markups. So these three are basically the same, it's just said in different ways, so studied in these three different ways. Okay, there's a direct contact with the target market. The sales staff provide customers with information with future market research. Because there's a direct relationship, direct channel, there's a quicker flow of information. Selling through the internet allows smaller business to market their products all over the world. See, I can sell from Jeffreys Bay into China or wherever, purely based on my internet selling skills. And therefore, I don't need a manufacturing or a wholesale retailer. Example of this would be there's a lot of people selling their leather shoes on Facebook, and they do it from a facility and then they ship out individual orders. So that's also a good effective strategy. Business websites can serve as a distribution method and a promotional method. Okay. Well-trained sales staff are able to promote products effectively to establish good relationships with consumers. And suitable intermediaries may not be available. So you might not be able to find good intermediaries, and therefore you keep it to yourself, do it yourself. Okay, so this is why you choose direct. Why you choose indirect is you want specialized agents to deal with customers. You don't want to train people, you don't want to hire people, you just want to outsource and let them deal with the customers. And you want them to take care of the transport and warehousing, the storage. There's no need to hire specialist sales staff. As I said, you don't need to do customer complaints. You enjoy benefits of bulk orders. So as a manufacturer, you sell in bulk. That's your main goal, and you can focus on that. And then they enjoy the benefits of ordering in bulk. There's better market coverage. You've got a massive range, because now you can reach more people than you could have reached your own. They understand how the market operates. Their consumers are spread across the country, and therefore their distribution is widespread as well. Now, when you do direct distribution, you will require a large investment in advertising. But with indirect, it's handled as you go on, and it's not the manufacturing or the manufacturer that's responsible for marketing. It's now the retailer's responsibility, for example. Intermediaries sometimes provide credit to consumers, and that will possibly attract more consumers. So let's say your retailers, shop will give credit. Consumers can buy only in 30 days. That means they can buy more now, which means your product might be able to sell now, but you will be paid. Okay, so that means you get sales. Okay, so that summarizes the video. So please take your textbook, make your notes. Between the slides, the video, and the PDF I shared, as well as your textbook, and then do your informal activity as well as the activities in the book.